From Kobe University. I'd like to talk about the party leakage estimation with a new dissipated energy data analysis. This is outline of my presentation. Let me start my presentation from introduction. And next, I'd like to talk about the party leakage estimation method based on the dissipated energy. And next, experimental result. In this presentation, I'd like to propose the accuracy improvements technique of the party limit estimation. We propose two method techniques. First one is a phase double frequency doping infrared method, and second one is a new estimation scheme. Finally, conclude my presentation. Party limit estimation based on the dissipated energy has been getting increased attention because of its time and cost effectiveness. So in this presentation, party limit estimation was applied to evaluate the pre-strain material, and we discussed the actual improvement of this estimation method. Let me explain the dissipated energy and the measurement method. When applied the cyclic loading was applied to the material, some elastic temperature change can be observed on the surface. So this temperature change is a reversible phenomenon. But in actually, the temperature rise due to irreversible energy dissipation occur in the material due to the plastic deformation. So this temperature rise occur at the maximum stress and the minimum stress. So the total temperature change can be observed like this. Dissipated energy can calculate this equation, density and heat capacity and temperature change. So there is two main method for measurement of dissipation and dissipated energy. One method is utilize average temperature rise. This is a previous presentation. Average temperature rise is caused by the irreversible energy dissipation. So the dissipated energy can be evaluated from the amount of average temperature rise from certain number of loading cycles. So this delta TV can be measured by a common infrared camera, but it's easy to detect it by the environment. And the other method is lock-in algorithm. Temperature change due to irreversible energy dissipation has a double frequency of loading signal. So this delta TV can be observed as a component having double frequency of the reference loading signal. So it can be obtained by lock-in algorithm. In this study, we use the lock-in algorithm to obtain the dissipated energy. This slide shows the party limit estimation based on the dissipated energy. It's like a previous presentation. So a staircase-like stress level test is carried out, and the dissipated energy is measured for each stress level, like this. The change of dissipated energy shows sharp increase from a certain stress level. So the measurement results are divided into the two groups, and the approximate straight line is generated for each group. The point where the two lines cross is determined as the estimated party limit. Let me proceed to the experimental result. The material under the test is a type 316L austenitic stainless steel. The specimen is subjected to the unidirection pre-strain at the level of 6% and 15%. And this slide shows the property of the infrared camera and the cyclic loading condition. The temperature resolution of the camera is 225 mK. So let me explain the phase analysis of the dissipated energy. When the cyclic loading applies the material, temperature change can be observed like this. So the single frequency of this temperature change indicates the thermoelastic gradient. And the double frequency component indicates the energy dissipation. So we have a question. When does energy dissipation occur? So is this model correct? Or phase advance or a phase delay? To investigate the phase analysis, we conducted the phase analysis to this temperature change. So amplitude of and the phase lag of thermoelastic temperature change can be obtained by this Lockwin algorithm. And this way, same way, the magnitude and the phase lag between the temperature rise due to the irreversible dissipation and the load signal can be obtained by this equation. So we define the phase difference, this phase lag, we define this phase lag as the phase difference of the dissipated energy. This slide shows the histogram of the phase difference change. Right-hand side of figure shows the histogram of the phase difference in the measurement field. This histogram plotted against the all stress level. And left-hand side figure shows, in this figure, the average phase of phase difference from calculated from here. Average phase difference is plotted against the stress amplitude. As you can see, when the applied stress amplitude is below the fatigue limit, histogram has two peaks at 60 degrees and 140 degrees. On the other hand, the applied stress is above the fatigue limit. The histogram shows the one peak at 60 degrees. So we consider that this component at 60 degrees is related to the irreversible energy dissipation per cyclic loading. And this component is maybe a noise component. So the temperature change due to energy dissipation has a specific phase difference. So we utilize this phase, specific phase difference. So we propose a phase double frequency Lockwin method. This figure shows the intensity and the phase difference obtained by the conventional Lockwin method. And this figure shows the relationship, relationship between intensity and the phase difference. In the conventional Lockwin method, the dissipated energy is obtained as a double frequency component, but it contains the noise component. So in the phase Lockwin method, the correlation value between the measured temperature change and the modified difference signal is calculated. This modified difference signal is shifted from the load signal by a specific phase difference. And this figure shows the result of the phase Lockwin method. A specific phase is 57 degrees. As you can see, this concentration of the dissipated energy can be observed as a notched root. And the noise is removed from this figure. We apply this phase double frequency Lockwin method to the pre-strained specimen. An SM curve for pre-strained specimen is shown here. And the value of fatigue limit is changed depending on the level of the pre-strain. the dissipated energy obtained by the conventional locking method is shown here. Dissipated energy slightly increases with increasing the stress level, and estimated fatigue limit doesn't coincide with actual fatigue limit. Like this. And the dissipated energy obtained by the phase locking method is shown here. And the dissipated energy for low stress level is smaller than that was obtained by conventional locking method. We applied the fatigue limit estimation estimated from this result. And the estimated fatigue limit is shown here. Estimated fatigue limit for a 0% specimen coincides with the actual fatigue limit. But that for 6% and 50% is larger than actual one. So it's a danger estimation. So we discussed about this difference. The dissipated energy for a 0% specimen sharply increased around the fatigue limit. But on the other hand, the change of dissipated energy for a 6% and 15% specimen show a quadratic curve near the beginning of the increase in the dissipated energy. This tendency here, or tendency of dissipated energy, show the plastic formulation effect, which influences the behavior of the sleep band movement and formulation and fatigue strength. So we investigate this difference. We observe the specific surface and investigate the behavior of sleep band. The change of number of sweep bands in the evaluation area is shown here. The stress level where the number of sweep bands increase coincides with the stress level where the dissipation energy starts to grow up each specimen. Here. So in our previous study, the stress level where the dissipated energy shows sharp increase indicates a crack initiation stress level based on the activity of dislocation movement. So we should detect that this stress level start to grow up, dissipated energy start to grow up. So we propose a new estimated scheme. In this scheme, the increase rate of the dissipated energy against the stress amplitude is calculated by the 3 or 5 point incremental polynomial method. The increase rate of the dissipated energy is like this. It's divided into two groups. And approximate straight line is generated for each group. And the point where the two lines cross is determined as the estimated fatigue limit. This table shows the result obtained by a new fatigue limit scheme. That estimated value for 0% and 60% specimen coincides with actual stress fatigue limit. And 15% specimen is 2. We can get good result. Finally, I conclude my presentation. The new fatigue limit estimation scheme for orthostatic stainless steel was proposed. The new dissipated energy measurement technique, it's the phase double frequency locking method, can remove the noise component. The new fatigue estimation scheme was applied to the free-strain authentic stainless steel. The fatigue limit for a free-strain material can be evaluated well by this new fatigue limitation scheme. Thank you for your kind attention.